so please stop me if I ask a question as I get along. I'm going to try and get through. I have a lot of slides in here, so don't get disparaged if I just go through it a little quickly. But anyway, this is my team. Like I said, we're a bunch of software engineers. The two pillars underneath me are pre-sales engagements, where we do request-based support. Basically, a deal with the help desk. They have an escalator need, partner rollout, usually for a large deal. My engineers get involved, you know, we're kind of outside the process, trying to figure out what's going on, maybe technically, to get past the issue. So we're not doing the engagements, we're doing software development, proof of concept samples, demos. Other people in the company do what I do. We're just basically the engineering side saying, hey, let's try to provide technical resources when it gets to the business unit level. So we're kind of saying that's what you do. You guys answered the question. Being that most of you guys are in the Windows space, I'm not going to spend much time on part two, but I am going to touch upon a couple of topics, so I'm going to try to get through part one quickly. I felt any talk about migrating from Windows to Android, you have some fundamentals of what Android is and the pieces involved, so I'll touch upon that. It may go a little quickly, but stop me from going too fast on those questions. And part two will be, for guys who are already doing Android code, there's some techniques which you guys developers would pick up on as little tips. But I'm gonna, the goal here is to give you enough information to enable you to go forward in the program exercise. Okay, so that's a pretty simple slide. But when you do migration of Android, you know, I kind of put three buckets here. There's other buckets you can go through, but when you look at it, you have a Windows mobile application or CE applications working well, you know, how do you get sort of Android? And the joke that everybody has is, well, yeah, just rewrite it all. It works great, but the problem is not everybody can invest in a full line development. And under business pressure, people do try to get their solution over to an Android as quick as possible. So they do these cross-platform tools and cross-platform frameworks, Xamarin, for example. If you are fortunate enough to have a solution that's developed today for a web framework, for example, the porting effort is not as bad, right? You just run the browser, but then you're at the mercy of the browser or whatever that containing framework is. So I just want to touch base on three different, you know, pros and cons of going through the different approaches. So .NET on Android, Xamarin, web frameworks, things like that. Big pluses, get quick time to market. Almost a drop dead, same similar UI in your products. Problem is that UI is going to stick with you even if it's contrary to the platform. You know, it's going to be whatever that framework is exposing to you as a need. Another negative here is for long term, and this is just what we're kind of hitting recently, you'll find that Android, especially when it comes to UI and background services, there's a life cycle that's maintained. It's not a memory kill, it's very aggressive in Android. You know, it's very efficient memory management. And as a result of that, your apps can be killed at pretty much any time it's not visible. And if you don't design for that in your application for the Windows days, it could cause you some mistake persistence issues. Android mandates it has to be memory for tools. The frameworks kind of do that for you, but they don't really let the application know. So unless you put hooks in the application, which you could, you just have to know that those hooks are happening. The other approach is a new approach, which is the recommended. Again, a little more, the con is time to market, a little bit of learning curve. I'll just say the investment in the training and tools, it's not as big. You're not gonna have a, you can go very deep with Android, but you're gonna be powerful very quickly between the context-sensitive IDE, the wealth of knowledge available on networks. We'll get through it. Android is a very top operating system. I would say 80 to 90% of what we're looking for is just about doing a Google search, how to do a function. Unlike Windows, it was all segmented to Microsoft for the most part. Then you have the hybrid approach, which, I'll cross-platform some of it, and I'll keep some of the data, and I'll do it. Problem is, over the long term, you do get feature creep, the complexity of the application, the maintenance of many apps, and stuff becomes a problem. So I'm going to concentrate on the middle box, but I just want to expose, you know, some fundamental similarities and differences as we go through this. So again, I put it together a quick table. Column one with the numbers are just basically areas I'm going to dive into the deck. So the hope here is if I don't get to the full deck in time, you have enough material to take back with me to make yourself powerful. So, you know, for Android guys, you have to state the obvious, but, you know, for the platform, people are next to using, you know, Visual Studio. But Android, it's mainly Android Studio, but there are people that find command line to be much more powerful. Main language, C, C++, .NET, yeah, you do Java. Those are predominant languages. In Android, if you're an application developer, you're mainly a Java developer. People do, if you're familiar with JNI, Java interfaces, there are people that do that, but it's an advanced, that's why it's an OEM space. But it's probably there in Java. Some of the big things I just wanted, and those are highlighted items here. Runtime security. I put Sentry for Microsoft, which I'll talk about, but one of the things you realize is in the Windows world, as an application developer, Windows CD, Windows Mobile, you have access to everything. Memory, registry, files. I call it semi because you can't modify system DLLs, you can't overwrite them. You could load it and replace them, but really it's systems and data. On Android, everything is sandboxed. Sandbox being security is the name of the game. Everything that you do in Android is security. Every folder you touch, only you can touch it, nobody else can get to it. They have this concept of signing, where you have to sign for permissions. You get certificates, and when you get, you adopt that permission level at installation time, then you have access to certain, even API calls or block. You can't do them unless you're signed or permission for them. Lifecycle model, which I'll get into deeper, has to do with, kind of like in Windows, you're taught there's a WinProc, or there's a WinName, you go in a loop, and yeah, you're supposed to do an uncreated on it, but you don't have to do it. On Android, it's strictly enforced. In fact, you'll find that the way Android applications work, if you don't follow the lifecycle model, they're going to be sorry. You know, if you ever use your Android phone, which some people have, you put an app in the background very easily. This whole notion of foreground background apps, anything in the background is subject to be killed. You know, in fact, it's even on a phone. You can hit clear now, and it kills all the apps in the background. And again, I'm going to speed the log here, but that's kind of like a general touch. I'll go into these in depth. So another basic difference I wanted to, you know, kind of walk into this is another stark difference between Windows Mobile and Android. Windows Mobile CD world is low, is roughly low-end hardware. You know, it's more of an embedded device, meant to be, you know, how do you get a real operating system on an embedded device, which happens to have a user interface. Contrast with what Android is, it's a much stronger multi-core CPUs, multicast, it's high-end hardware. And that's part of the technology trend that we are playing. So just keep that in mind. So now you're dealing with highly capable hardware. The kind of the problem that Windows Mobile goes away, memory constraint, you know, you're back like almost like a desktop world, but in the Android world, you have other things to deal with, but it's a much more capable system. You get a much more rich in UI, for example, things like that. And again, just, I'm going to stop over quick here, but just looking at development environments, depending upon those three models, you have Android Studio, you have Visual Studio, which, believe it or not, because Visual Studio is an IDE for Android. You know, that's the demo I think that we served this morning. Cordova is a cross-platform tool, similar to our Rho mobile product, if you guys have used that in the past. And then we have Xamarin, which is .NET on, you can still use your .NET and many other stuff going on. If you guys haven't seen this yet, I'm just going to touch upon it basically. I'll compare this to the Windows model, the Windows CD model. I'm going to start from the bottom upwards, but what it comes down to is Android is based upon Linux. It's a secure, as the Linux versions increase with version letters, the features of those languages, of Unix increases, security, things like that. So I just start seeing the Android, which is version generated by letters, or desserts, you'll see the feature sets increase, and they're really driven by the Linux stuff. But you have Linux kernel, which abstracts the hardware. Then you have some native libraries, which basically abstracts Apple's data, you know, abstractions into libraries that you call. And there's a special segment of these libraries called the Android runtime, which is basically, in the Windows world, think of it as a virtual machine, and that's exactly what it is in Android. You run within this Java virtual machine called Babel, or Zygote, and look at that. It's one process. And that one process is what's driving the interpretation of all your Java code or your Android code. Again, you don't know this as an application developer other than at runtime, this is what's running. It's the function is running at runtime. At the framework level, this is Java code. That's an infrastructure on top of native libraries that basically gives you the entire, everything you read about Android from an application development standpoint is in this application framework. This is is all your libraries, how services work, how Google works, all that fun stuff. And above that are your typical applications that you run and build a workflow. So there should be no surprises there. But from the application layer, you're generally dealing with the application framework. Very rarely you're going out to the native level. Okay, compare that with the, another thing worth comparing is the security involved here. You know, you might go from up here down here very easily. The Windows world was basically two modes, kernel mode and user mode. And when you're in user mode, carte blanche, do whatever you like, your Java code in Windows normal, Windows CE world is basically not in the, you know, seen as a special type of application. Your .NET app or your Java app is actually running within and out of application code, the virtual machine. But all this is global, seen as all flat, access anything you want, and it was a kernel mode. That's pretty much it. Very complex. Again, I talked about security. There's a lot of security accesses. Remember, everything is in its own folder and sandbox. You don't have permission to every folder, every resource. Think in L. KitKat and earlier, you could actually access the SD card without issue. They're actually kind of security on that now. You need special permissions to get to the storage card of your device. So it is getting tighter each time, but you know, the whole notion is your sandbox in your application. Like another thing for comparison is, you know, I'm really gonna screw up. When you're talking Android, you're talking APK files, application package kit, I forget the exact acronym. But basically it consists of a .dex file. A .dex is similar to what you call an executable .dex file. Resources assets, consider these to be like your resource compiler on Visual Studio, built into the binary on an executable. You would just use part of the exit. In native libraries, you may actually see those if you do an advanced development, libraries. But predominantly, you'll either see APK files or ZIP files, and they're both based on the same format, ZIP format. So you'd actually be able to see it. Free with Java, it's a bunch of class files, and one that's a main, or even hyper. All right, so here's some of the concepts I want to just touch base on it, and it's basically these four components in the next slide are the main building blocks of every Android application. If you understand these four concepts, which I'll have a slide on each one, you pretty much get the gist of what Android is from an application standpoint. So you might have different activities, and it's really it's more than what I'm saying here, but just think conceptually. An activity in Android, think of it as a Windows class, you know, a main window. It's just, again, there's some natures with Android now, it's a flat screen, it's a little tiled interface, but I think when you hear activities, think Windows. When you hear services, think services. A service is just a background process running without a UI on it. A background thread, not a process. Could be a process. Broadcast receivers, think of this as being a message handler. I'll tell you about a concept called intent. In Windows, they have a very basic message structure. You have a one W param, L param, and then maybe you have set D word for extra data. You'll see a thing called an intent, which is basically the equivalent of a message in Android. It's a very dynamic data structure, and the data structure has certain meaning to it, but when you do inter-process communication, inter-direct communication, it's all about intents, and broadcast receivers are guys who are listeners, or kind of like your wind prop that says, hey, I'm going to listen to, you know, these type of messages coming in. Content provider is pretty much unique to Android. This pretty much takes away a lot of, I mean, apologize, this is the last session here, but your database management, right, the SQL code, you still do it, but Android has classes that takes care of all your data persistence for you. So you're not necessarily dealing with the low-level SQL insert delete record, but, you know, it's all built into the class structure there. So a lot of your storage, where it's going, how things are stored in the device, you have contacts, browser history, you get them all from these content providers. Views and layouts. Now, if you say an activity is a window, a view or a layout is kind of like the view area, or the viewport, if you will, in Windows. I call it a dialog box or UI components. Use the term dialog box loosely. There is an Android version of a dialog box. But I'll call that a pop-up in Windows language. But as far as Android goes, think of the view as a layout as a window, because that can lay out UI elements in a bundle or a rectangle. And that rectangle can be sized in that way. Intents I mentioned are like Windows messages, but a lot more. Resources, same concept. You know, things like string tables, icons, again, in your project. Everything's XML-based, as I'll show you in the open Word project. A lot more flexibility and capability in fact. Most of your Android development is going to be done, especially the UIs and resources you bring in, are going to be in XML format that are translated to visual representations of that XML. So a lot of that resources that you see in say, your resource compiler in Visual Studio is a very strong equivalent here in Android world. And it's cross device and cross language support a lot easier by having things in the resource file. And then they have a thing called a manifest. I try to equate it to like a modules.def file for the advanced C programs here. It's kind of like, you know, a manifest is a way of telling when you run my application, you tell the operating system, everything I export, everything I'm going to act upon. I'm going to register my app to act upon these components or hooks in the system. The equivalent in Windows would be if you write the DLL and you have a modules.def or an export file, it's like, hey, here's the functions that I export as default, you know, a library of that file. So with that, I mean, I'll get into what a typical Android project looks like. So when you do an Android project, you'll see a view like what's on the right here. It's kind of cryptic at first, but if you break down to its pieces, your actual code that you're working on comes in three different flavors, the actual code you're working on, and then two self-generated projects, which help you with automation and testing. But for the most part, you deal with your main Java program. You have a resource folder, which is item 2 here, and it's basically all your XML files that I mentioned, and the trees underneath it. Some of the key pieces of resources are resource values, which is your string tables, things like that, your color definitions. 5 is a, that's the Bible, that's the manifest. And then we have a build that Gradle. The manifest, like I said, we'll get into it, but it's an inventory of everything that contains. And then your Gradle scripts are built into the program. For the most part, as you're using IntelliSense and you're doing your builds, these Gradle scripts will go through and build a lot of overhead files. You'll actually find, if you look at Java code, this class called R for resources. You'll do a lot of your coding based upon that R file, which is basically just representations of these XML files, all of this within an XML file. So you can quickly identify buttons, strings, everything, all by the ID that the R file, that this R class gives you. But I wanted to give you that little exposure, because when you first get the Android, you break it up this way, this is your code, and all this stuff is supported with functions. Again, main mention of a manifest file, it's a one-time, it's a text-based file that you put in your development environment, and basically tells the operating system everything you're going to do. You declare what you are, what permissions you use, what intent filters, all sorts of things. If it's not the manifest file, OS is not going to do it. And then that's the problem. Okay, so I've got 5 minutes left. I'm going to go through this kind of quickly, so I'll get to the main points. One thing I want to talk about is when you do an activity or a component of an Android app, we're used to having a win main or win mole. You know. In Android, the framework is actually where your main thread is, you know, the high level Android classes. That's actually your main thread, you know, the classes up there. Your activity gets launched, or the activity portion of your application gets launched as a result of an listener that says, hey, the launcher wants you, so I'm going to go launch you what? You may have intent listeners that are independent of your activity, the broadcast listener. He'll get launched independent of the activity, because the manifest said, hey, all these hooks that I have in the system, these are the conditions in which you call upon me. So it's a little discerning, but trust me, you'll get used to it. It's very easy to think that an activity is your only main program, but it's not. It's the other components that I mentioned, the broadcast receivers, your services, those are all part of your application space. But they get invoked differently based upon the manifest and the listeners. I won't go too much into this. I do want to get into, I'm going to skip this, but this is basically how it looks like in the manifest file. And I'm sorry for going a little too fast to get on the next slide. I do want to think, it's best within 3 minutes. But, this is, you know, it really is a typical activity. Think of it as you go through window on create, you know, when cross part in the message loop. You have these states, and, you know, on create, on start, on resume, and you go into the background. This is hard for me to look at the Android documentation. You'll actually get these calls being made to your activity in your class that you would have on. The point I'm making here is there's two behaviors you want to be aware of. I'm just giving you some of the events. When an activity goes in the background, when it's non-visible, the on-pause method will be called. If you're doing any data persistence, anything in the UI, you want to store your name there, because once you go in the background, you're subject to be killed. So you do want to make sure you're active on the on-pause methods. The other thing is the simple notion of rotate the screen. Inherently, Android will go through all these states, effectively killing your app and restart it, just by doing the screen rotation. It doesn't kill the entire app, but it goes through enough of the states. If you follow the flow chart, it does an on-stop, on-destroy, on-start, on-stop, on-resume. Pretty much all the states do it. So it's a good way to test your application is by rotating. Because in essence, what you're doing is just rewiring and rewriting the entire activity. Again, I'm going to blow past this a little bit, but the services are background process, background thread. Services have their own life cycle, similar to activities on create, on start, they run and they go to bed. A balanced service has to do with if you actually attach it to a piece of code called an IDL, think of that with XCOM, that IDL language, you would actually balance that. And but you're running more independent of the activity, if you will, as your own tree. Broadcast receivers, I'm just going to jump ahead because I know this is probably getting too deep, but a broadcast receiver is just basically a thread that's listed or a hook that's listed into to somebody who sent an intent out to a system. Classic example is you have an APK that has this intent listeners. You didn't necessarily launch an APK, but system goes out and broadcasts a boot complete message or a download complete message. Anybody who has my manifest or message that says, I want to receive it, you'll get one, you know, a portion of your app will get you didn't launch and listen to it. So the whole notion of launching only when I click on it doesn't exist. People should register the system to be a broadcast receiver. Again, declaring the XML is an example of boot complete. There's some special notifications that go on in the system that we can't put in the XML. I'll make it to some, again, I'm going to skip to some of the events, being that also sort of the Windows side. I do want to get to it, the important set to part two about how to help yourself with certain things. So just bear with me, it'll be like 2 more minutes. But I do want to get through when we start Android, and I put references in the slides when you get them. This is a lot of standard documentation. Android, you know, AndroidDeveloper.com is the biggest, it's the Bible, the spec. There's a lot of good information there. I find just Google the topics is good enough, but I did want to teach you, you know, or just expose you a couple of things. Android Debug Bridge, think of AppForum. It's the equivalent of taking a PC and you connect it to a table, and then you can actually open an interface. It's a shell-based interface. The other part here is you're actually bound to use it with a USB cable. You could actually do it over network. In this class, in this session here, on your PC side, your DOS window, you type ADB connect, the IP address of who's out there listening. On your device, you'll have an ADB TCP command that says, hey, listen around port 5556, so you can actually do a full ADB session like that. Logcat, you guys are familiar with the bug messages. If you have a troubleshot issue with Zebra devices or OS devices, so they're called retail messages, those are our things. That's what Logcat is. It's inherent in the operating system. It's very structured, very focused, so you can actually increase and decrease the performance based on days. Logcat's the number one thing you want to know when you're troubleshooting issues. And I'll show you a technique how you take those Logcats and find the source code that goes with it. At the KCAT, they sort of restricted you to see this. It's called ANR, it's application not responsive. If you write a piece of code in your UI that's not responding to that lifecycle management calls, you'll see a message pop up that says, hey, process blah, stop responding. Do you want to wait and kill it? That's called an application not responsive. It's basically, the system thinks your application is deadlocked. there are dump files that get created. Up until KitKat, you could actually just browse and get it. You still could get them, but you gotta know the exact directory to go to. It's hard to do. It's all the storage stuff. But yeah, data A&R. The equivalent of an A&R, and you know, think about the latest one, native C code breaks, it's called the tombstone. That's at the Linux level. There's crashes there. So a typical crash in a program, you'll probably see an exception first in Logcat. You'll see a crash take place in an A&R, and then you'll see a tombstone. And effectively, these files will give you all the information on bug stuff that you need. There's another feature called a bug report. You'll see it on the UI, you'll be able to put the bug mode, or you can call it from the command shell. Bug report does a pretty much all these snapshots all at once, when you don't need to snap it or anything. And I do want to point out that we have a tool similar to NScript for Android called RxLogger. Quick thumb for that is it gives you a structured output on your storage card. It takes all the logs, puts them into a structured format. There's have a UI element, we configure plugins. You remember NScript was a plugin type of resource where we said, hey, you want to add more code to troubleshoot and do the area? We've made it a nice UI in front of it, so instead of having chat boxes. And then you get this. Also, there's like an NScript, a nice Excel sheet, and you do a timeline of data. You can do a whole topic just on that. Again, if you're familiar with Linux, there's some really cool commands you can do. This is really good input, processes, things like that. What I want to get to you real quick is, the name on here is Android's open source code. There is this website called Android XRef. The traditional view of looking at code that's open source is you'll go to a Git repository, download this open code, and go load it in a development station and go look at your code. There's this nice website called Android XRef. And if you're not familiar with Linux, this is a Unix vehicle get property. Vertical bar, you can chain together commands to say basically pick an output of this, and rather than show it on the screen, type it into the next command in the chain. This command is called, it's a Linux command called rep, in one case, and this is the string I'm looking for. You would get pop rep, the output would show a string of words with the word release in it, as opposed to all the properties in the system. And you'll see this is your Android version. Once you know your Android version, you go to that XRef site, and you can actually find the source code for that. What I find it very helpful for is in your typical Android shell, you're troubleshooting, you're doing logcat, you see little trace messages going on. You may run across a message and say, well, where's that coming from? Is it my code? Is it from open source code? So in this example, I took a program with a line of code, you know, that comes out in the string, where I type in logcat, you'll see this thing pop up on the screen. And you see a message comes up. It says, service manager waiting for service. So, and by the way, the format of this logcat is date timestamp, process ID, thread ID, a tag, and then the actual message. So that tag is something that's different from all log messages. But the actual code may look like something with parentheses in it, or you're not sure. So you go to XRef, you'll basically take that string and say, hey, it's probably in a printf statement somewhere. Because I don't think Android puts that into their open source. They probably put a percent test or something. So basically, we take that, we go to the XRef site, we'll punch in that field, and I'll give you a better view on the next slide, where you type in the string that you're looking for. There's all the definitions, the symbols, all sorts of tests. And this piece over here will actually give you the subsystem which you're looking at. All those, the hierarchy I showed you of classes and code, that's what these subsystems are. They're just separate projects in the Migrate OS. And in this example, we typed in that string. I did select all, and it basically found everywhere where Spartan command service is found. There's the source code. I can find the history of that checking, the definition of where it is, and the activity log. And basically, this would actually give me, if I click on it, the actual source code for that project. So, very helpful if you have a problem, something's not working right. Reverse engineer your debug message or your logcat message to the actual source code. In fact, when you come to support, there's a whole one-stop method of going to Microsoft. We struggled with that in Windows Mobile because we didn't have Microsoft binaries to look at. So now when you come to Zebra for support, we'll actually say, oh, Android open source code, and this is how it's behaving. All right. Sorry, I'm running out of time. I think people got it. So what I want to do is, I just want to share that one technique with you. I apologize that I don't have to go into the deeper topics. sort of go past this. And there's a lot of stuff I can give you, but being that we're not really with an Android crowd, I just want to give you that exposure to Windows, which I've been Android. But I did want to share with you, though, in closing thoughts, right? The migration is, if you can do a complete rewrite, do it. It's worth the time to do it. You just not out of question. If you know, if you wrote in Java, if you wrote in C, then you can take that same logic and put it over, right? And I see a rewrite, structural rewrite. You know, you class, you have this code to work in the classes that work for Android. There's a lot of accelerated, you know, development tools that we'll have in doing Android. IntelliSense and a lot of these open source tools. It's a growing repository. It's very powerful. Debugging tools are powerful. You can do a lot of stuff in Windows, for example, without the hardware that you can do in Windows. And the learning curve, it's there. It shouldn't be too drastic. And I'll tell you, Google search is 90% of what you're looking for, 80-90%. Yeah, object oriented C is, you know, shifted from Java, truly object oriented code, to what we call object oriented in the Windows world, when we just really write C code with object oriented features. Java really does, if you look at the actual code, it really is, well, you have a base class, and I'm just overriding one method in that base class, and nothing happens. If you get past that little hurdle, it's actually very easy. So you kind of like got to dive in, but I think the system view will look at it and say, well, I see what's going on now, right? This activity class is already defined for me. I'm just calling one method in that class that does all the magic. So that's the name of the biggest hurdle. You get past that, and everything falls in place next to it. Again, this is the Bible. I have some references on the next slide that you guys can use. There's a nice tutorial one I'm going to recommend you guys do, but this is a lot of advances and growing popularity across space, which is commercial. As far as recommendations, you know, I found this on the Google search. This one here, tutorialspoint.com/android. Do this for, I think, 4 days. it's a nice, you know, non-complicated, very easy to follow PowerPoint, set of PowerPoints that can actually walk you through the exercises. If I had to recommend one of these, other than the Bible, right? I would recommend that tutorial. It's a pretty helpful one. And I'm sorry if I sound rushed. I did want to cram a lot in there. I kind of wasn't sure if it would roll along the Android development because it's just stuck in the house. Any questions, comments, concerns, thoughts? Back a bit. Have a sandwich. Okay, so if you could, just don't forget about the surveys, and you know, see me around, maybe we'll answer any questions.